That's good. All right. Good morning and welcome to this week's edition of NCompass Live. I am Krista Porter here at the Nebraska Library Commission. NCompass Live is the Commission's weekly online event, webinar, webcast, online show, where we cover anything of interest to libraries. We're very broad in what we cover here. All types of libraries, all types of activities are doing at libraries. That's really our only focus, is anything library related. The show and our recordings are free and open to anyone to watch. We do the show live on Wednesday mornings at 10 a.m. Central Time. But if you're unable to join us on Wednesdays, we do record every week, and those recordings are posted to our website afterwards. And I'll show you at the end of today's show where you can find all of our recordings. We have all of our recordings archives go back to the first show, which was in January 2009. And we have the show themselves. Our video is on our YouTube account. If there's any presentations or handouts or documents included, those are up there as well. And any websites or links that people have mentioned during shows, we gather them all together in our Delicious account to save bookmarks together and provide that for you as well. As I said, we do a mixture of things here: book reviews, training sessions, presentations, demos of services or products, basically anything libraries are doing, are involved in, something we think might be of use to libraries is on the show. We do bring in guest speakers sometimes, but we also do presentations from our Nebraska Library Commission staff. And we have sort of a combination of that today. Mm-hmm. with me today is Mary Jo Ryan, Communications Coordinator here at the Nebraska Library Commission. And on the other side there, JoAnn McManus, who's our grant coordinator for various grants, specifically today talking about the internship one. And also on the line with us is Laura Yoakum. I'm just getting over to her thing to unmute her. From Wilson Public Library here in Cozad, Nebraska, who's going to talk about their experiences at internships.
Hi, Laurie.
How are you?
Good. Good to have you with us.
Good morning.
Thank you.
All right. I think you guys are going to start, right?
Yeah,
all right.
We are.
So I will just hand over to you to tell us all about how to do some great internships.
Terrific.
Very good.
Good to be here with you all today. Planning for successful internships. Now, let's see. That didn't work.
Again. There we go.
All right. We do have two audiences this morning. We have just announced the 2017 internship grant awardees, and many of them are on the line, as well as some awardees from past years. However, this particular session is going to be of interest to anyone who is interested in having an intern in their library, and we have some of those also viewing today across Nebraska and, of course, across the country as well. And so I think that everyone will find something of value today. So what's the secret, JoAnn?
Plan.
Secret's out. And we have heard this. As a matter of fact, at the end of last year's internship program, we had a survey to the supervisors saying, what might you do differently if you did it again that you learned this year? And we heard a lot of people saying more upfront planning, and that we actually have a quote here, planning makes all the difference. The detailed calendar was extremely useful. It kept us on track. So, you know, we encouraged them to do that, and obviously it worked. And, of course, planning is important, and as all of you may think back to job experiences, your first day on the job, I think all of us have had those jobs where you might even inquire about a job opportunity and the supervisor had a little bit of trouble describing the job duties, or you start the job and the supervisor isn't quite prepared to get you started that day, and you might even sit around half the day on that first day not really doing anything because they're not quite prepared. And that won't be happening here. We hope not. And I think in short-term internships, that is really important to be prepared because you don't have the luxury of having all that many hours for that intern anyhow. And so it is important to plan ahead of time and to be ready. And of course, not only are you wasting their time, but your time as well. I think that even though we do have, we are providing $1,000 to 21 different libraries, 27 if you count Lincoln and Omaha as their separate branches. Anyone really can find some funds to get an internship.
Yeah, we do want to encourage everyone, whether you received a grant or not, to move forward on trying to get that funding.
Right.
It's not that hard to get. People are really supportive of this idea.
Right. And one thing that came to mind this year as I was reading the intern applications is that one of our libraries said that they are, if they get a grant, and they did, they were going to use that opportunity to really showcase what that intern did to their city. And they wanted to show, we really need another staff, we need more hours, and look at what this one person was able to do for mm-hmm. us. And so, you know, take advantage of, if you're one of those that have a grant, take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. There's two ways to provide payment to interns, and this is both whether you're getting a grant or not. You can either hire that intern as a part-time temporary employee and give them an hourly wage, or because they're students, you can use a stipend-based internship. And of course, if it's through the grant, we suggest that since it's $1,000, that you give those stipend payments and probably a couple different payments so they don't get all their money all at once, or they don't have to wait for all of their money till the end of the internship.
Here at the Library Commission, we've had a variety of interns, and we've done it different ways depending on how the college or the institution suggested. But I always felt bad for the interns when we didn't pay them until the end of the semester because mm-hmm. they work all those hours before mm-hmm. they get anything. Mm-hmm.
And in Nebraska, for those of you who are joining us in Nebraska, whether you're paying an hourly rate or a stipend base, it really does have to be equivalent to at least minimum wage. And in Nebraska, that is $9 per hour. And then there is an exception, and again, I'm talking Nebraska law, that if it's a student worker, you can pay them a training wage, which would at least be 75% mm-hmm. of minimum wage. So it is possible, since these are students, that you pay them less. I think almost everybody that has done interns with us in the past have paid at least the minimum wage. But remember to check whether you're getting a grant or not. You're probably associated with the city or county, and so do check with them on any stipulations that they might have when you're hiring.
What's next?
Oh, well, you got to have some goals. The internship is going to be more successful if you pay attention to what goals you have. And, of course, you need to start with, if you are getting a grant, you need to start with the goals of the Nebraska Internship Grant Program, which include, but I think these are important to anybody, involve the student in real library work. Obviously, you don't want them sweeping floors all day long. You need to provide a view of the role of libraries, library operations, and the role of technology. You might have them focused on a specific project. Maybe they're only working on the website, or they're only working on whatever the case may be. But do still tell them about a lot of other things that go on in libraries today. And ensure that the internship serves as a recruitment tool to help the student view library work as a viable career path. So obviously you're also talking about where they can get education, what other types of jobs are available in libraries. You might be from a library that's very small and might not have all of the tools that others have, but you know, still mention that when they're with you.
Well, and sometimes I know that some of the libraries have taken the interns on field trips to other libraries so they can see mm-hmm. what a college library is like, what a bigger library is like, what a smaller library is like. So that's always good, too.
That's right. And then, of course, after you look at our goals, obviously you'll have goals of your own. And it might be to expand a program, to work on things like the website or social media, reorganize an area, assist customers using the computing area, and obviously you all have goals as well, and if feel free throughout the conversation today to type in your comments or type in your questions, and
or raise your hand if you'd like to speak. Krista mm-hmm. will notice if you raise your hand mm-hmm. on that little place on the side, on the right side? Does it still look like a hand since they changed it?
Should. I'm not, see, I have it.
They changed the interface, so we're not sure if it still looks like a hand, but it used
to. This is as an organizer, I don't have that same view. But yeah, somebody did have their hand raised earlier testing it out, I saw before we started.
Okay, so that'll work. Yeah. So yeah, let us know if you have questions by raising your hand or by typing them in the comment section.
But having your goals, even not just a list of tasks, but your goals will help you to always remind yourself, oh yeah, we need to refocus on what we wanted to accomplish here.
Yeah. And I noticed that some of the libraries have goals that relate to the community, having the intern understand more about the library's role in the community and community engagement. I thought that was really good, too.
So once you have your goals, you need to actually put together your work plan. What will the duties of the intern be? And if you're a successful internship grant applicant, you already described those in your grant application, and sometimes we get a question, well, now we have some other ideas. And so do you really need to stick to that described list of activities, or can you go a different direction? And it's possible that you did have a successful grant application because of those activities that you described. But of course, we want you and that student to have a great experience, and we do want you to make use of the intern's talents and skills. Maybe you didn't think of them helping on your website, but all of a sudden you're interviewing an intern and you see all these talents and skills that they have, and you might want to go a different direction. So, yep, we can be flexible. And our request, when you want to make adjustments, See my puppy dog eyes there.
I know.
She's begging them to help me out here.
JoAnn has read the research on how people love the dogs and cats in their images. She's all over it.
So if you are deviating significantly from your grant-funded work plan, please email me and let me know what you're adding, what you're eliminating, and that way if we see any issues, we can visit about that. But we want to be flexible and help you out. Okay, so the timing of your internship. Those that got the grant, that internship can be any time between you have a signed agreement, and you don't have that yet, and we'll talk about that later. But they do have to be wrapped up by the end of November. And you might want to consider the student's schedule when they're available. The best time, obviously, for your library, you want to think about that. And a lot of times we see in our grant applications that people want that internship during their various busy time, during summer reading programs and things of that nature. And you might want to think about that. Is that really when you want them? Maybe the busiest time isn't the best, at least not getting them started. Because if it's too crazy, how much time can you work with that intern?
So maybe get them started ahead of time.
Right. But of course, typically students are more flexible during the summer hours. Okay, so recruitment. Recruitment is very important to get you an intern that will work good. You need to think ahead of time before you even know who might be interested in your internship. What kind of skills and attributes are you looking for that intern to be successful in performing tasks? What's the best age range for the student? Are you going to be recruiting a college student because of what you're going to be asking of that student? Or will high school student work? Or are you going to put feelers out in both areas because you know either might work for you? I did want to, even though it can be either a high school or a college age student, I do want to give you a little bit of tip on hiring someone under 16. And this is in Nebraska. Other states might have different laws. But in Nebraska, if you're hiring someone under age 16, there's going to be limits on the number of hours that you can have them working and when they can be working, and you also are required to get a properly executed employment certificate from your school. Mm-hmm. And so that is an extra step. And here are just some things to think about if you get someone under 16. During the school year, they can only work up to 3 hours a day, Monday through Friday. And if it's during the school year, they also cannot work past 7 p.m. And a lot of times you might want them to come in to help with the program. Is your program really going to be over by 7 p.m.? And if it's not, if you have a 14 or 15-year-old, they won't be able to work on that. In the summer, it is 9 p.m., so it's a little bit more flexible. But again, sometimes you have a program that's wrapping up at 9, and then you want them to stay after cleanup. So this is just some extra thoughts. And if you do hire a 14 or 15-year-old or are considering that, I do have a 3-page document that tells all the ins and outs about that. So definitely request that of me.
And if you have any questions about that, just go ahead and type them in there in your chat box right now, and we'll try to address them. But probably the best thing is to read the document if you really are planning on hiring a 14 or 15-year-old.
Right. Okay, so once you know whether you're hiring them as a part-time employee or a stipend-based intern, and you know what the job duties are, and you know what skills would be ideal, now you're ready to search for your intern. It's better to do that ahead of time before you start to see your possible interns, and then you go, wow, now I'm going in a whole different direction. So how do you get the word out? There's plenty of ways to advertise your job opening. Local newspaper, of course, whether that's articles and classified ads. Your high school career counseling office and school librarians are also good places. If you're going to be recruiting a college student, obviously the community colleges and other colleges and universities. On the Nebraska Department of Economic Development's website, they have the internne.com, and that is kind of a one-stop shop for paid internships in Nebraska. And so that might be a good place to drop that ad. And then, of course, on our website at Now Hiring at Your Library, we can post jobs. As a matter of fact, I went to there yesterday and saw Lincoln has their internships already posted on there. So
let me show you where those are, huh? Here is, oops, I had it up here. Maybe it's gone. Oh, there it is. Okay. Nebraska Library Commission, if you go down here to Jobs, Careers, Now Hiring, you'll get here to internships directly. And that's where the information is about internships. But you were talking about over here under Post a Job. This is where you would post your job.
Right.
This is where you would view the jobs that are available.
And there's Lincoln. So grant, library grant funded intern.
So they are able to just put a little information in here. It's pretty easy to do. So we kind of recommend it, especially if you're looking for a college student. They would use the web to look for a job,
right,
or internship.
Right. And you can post it in your library. And you guys probably have great ideas as well how you can get the word out.
Does anybody want to share any ideas at this point?
Yeah, go ahead and type in your question section. Let us know if you had any successful or unsuccessful places.
I'm particularly interested in how, if there are any of you that are using social media to recruit or to share information about internships. Have any of you tried on social media? I know a lot of students are using Snapchat. I mean, trying to think how that would work.
I don't know if that's a way to really promote things, yeah.
Yeah, but Facebook would be a way in that it reaches an older demographic, but those people are parents and grandparents and might know of somebody who's looking for an internship or a summer job.
Or Instagram, as you can do more on there because you can put a link to something.
Instagram might be a good possibility. That could be a good one.
And if you are getting one of the internship grants and you hire someone and they're not working out or they're, took a different job.
Put that on Instagram. No.
Through, you can certainly just let us know that you're going to get a different intern. And so just because you said who you're going to hire and they might have even started, we can, you know, back up, get you, you know, you get another intern and away we go. So we are flexible in that. Okay, so selection and interviewing. A lot of people ask if you need to follow the same process if you are hiring a permanent employee. That is really up to you. You might want to visit with your city and county if you're associated with them, because they might have some very specific ideas on how you get an intern or what that process will be. But it is good to have a process.
And to follow the local process if you speak to the city and county and find out what their municipal process is, go by that.
Right. And even though you can be a little bit more flexible with an intern that's only going to be with you, you know, a short time, I think you're going to find that if you do have a more structured interview process, they're going to take the job a lot more seriously. They realize right up front that it's a real work experience. And I think they will prove to be a more valuable intern and worker for you. So before you start your interviewing, develop questions to help you determine if they have the right skill. Will they be dependable? Are they open to learn new things? Do they have the social skills needed to work in a library? I think a lot of library work, we all know that there's so many social skills that you use every day. You have to deal with people. You have to be pleasant. So certainly you're going to find that out in the interview. Are they interested in the planned task areas that you have for them? And do they have that talent? And then, of course, ask some questions that also gets at their other talents. So even though you might be planning a very couple specific tasks, if you ask them more open-ended questions about their interests and talents, then you might find out that, oh, I can also have them help me with that. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, keep that in mind as well when you're developing those questions.
Oh, we actually have, hang on here, I missed it here. Lori, hang on, Lori, Lori. I saw you typed a few things in the chat there, Lori. I've unmuted you, though. You could share what you guys did.
As far as marketing, we did post it on Facebook and actually got a lot of shares. It was kind of a crazy thing. Parents saw that and shared it to their kids or other people that they thought had kids that might be interested in it. And we also partnered with our school, who tweeted it out, and they have a lot of the kids are on Twitter as far as communicating with the schools. So we got a great promotion by the school, and we ended up having a lot of people apply.
Wow, that's a real success story, isn't it?
Nice.
Well, okay, take note. If you can get the school to tweet it on their network.
Yeah.
You've got some ready ears.
And that's a good tip. Find out from your school where these teens are, how they are communicating with the kids, because they'll know the best way, because they know how they're getting the information out to them.
Yeah.
And you can, like you guys did, tag along with that.
Yeah. And with the parents, with school closures and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
whatever network they use, that's great, Lori.
Yeah.
Thanks. More on your interviewing.
Yeah, determine the criteria that you're going to be looking at before you get the interview process started. That will help you refocus on what you're interested in, and maybe the interviewing process won't change your focus. It might, because you might find somebody who's very talented in that area. But kind of if you think about that criteria in advance, I think it will help you. And then, so after all your interviews, you go ahead and select your intern.
An intern.
I think you might want to get someone who's there for the right reason.
Oh,
okay, that's better.
There's a better intern. play.
I don't think they were students. You might you need
yeah, to they might not actually, but you never know. They could be students.
Okay, so after you find your perfect intern, you agree on a start date, and before that first day, please talk to other staff members that you have so they know what's going on. And I think what I've heard in follow-up surveys is that those libraries that do have multiple staffs, they have come back and said, I'm going to make sure that they spend time, the intern spends time with each staff person. Mm-hmm. So, because not only does the intern have a very thorough view of the library, if they get to do that, but I think when other staff are asked to share what they do, it kind of makes them take a different look at how they are doing their work. And so I think that we've had some success in just laying better groundwork at the library. Take another look at the work plan. Should it be tweaked to capitalize on the intern's talents? Get organized, have a plan, know what you're going to be doing, know what the intern, what you want the intern to be doing, and then put together a flexible timeline. So kind of pencil out what things you want to accomplish when they're there. And then, of course, be flexible, because obviously some things might take longer. Other things will take less than you think. And in that timeline, obviously, you're going to want to introduce them to the projects that they're going to be working on, but also orient them to the work of the library. So show them some other things, even though they might not be working in those areas. And then, of course, share information about education opportunities in library sciences and other career paths. You love your job. Make sure that you show them that, you know, those are great jobs. Mm-hmm. So when, as your intern's making progress, go ahead and track that. That way, at the end, you can report on their progress and what's happened. You can also, that also allows you to make adjustments along the way and provide guidance. If you keep following up with your intern, it confirms that they understood the assignment, so time isn't being wasted. If they're progressing faster than you thought on a particular project, you'll be ready to introduce them to the next assignment. If you keep checking back with them, it allows you to also give them timely feedback, and that's important. And checking back with them also makes it easier for them to ask you questions. And what other benefits have you found to, you know, kind of keeping track of your intern's progress? These are just a few that I've gleaned from surveys we've
been asked. Reading the evaluations.
Yeah, if anybody has any thoughts, type it in. Let us know if you need your microphone. Or Lori, if you have anything, I've left you unmuted so you can chime in whenever you want.
Okay, so what leads to good experiences, and this is a good place for you to type in as well. Obviously, the $1,000 that they'll be getting is through this grant is a plus, but what else is valuable to them? It'll hopefully they'll gain valuable experience. They can use their internship on future job and college applications. They're making a difference in lives, and I think that makes them feel good about themselves. They're making new friends. What else happens as far as a good experience for the intern?
Has anybody had any feedback from their interns about what they thought about it afterwards?
Because Krista, can I say something?
Oh, yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Lori.
What I found with my intern last year was that we did a field trip. We went to the Kearney Public Library because it's so much bigger than ours. And we also went to UNK Library so he could see a more academic setting, which was great for him because he is now at UNK this fall. And so I think one of the things on your slide you should add is networking, because he was able to meet people there. He actually, the first week of school, that's when your jobs on campus become available, and he went back into the library, interviewed there, was offered a job there, and actually he ended up taking a job at the Frank Museum. So he had two offers because of what he had done for us through his internship.
Wow.
And that really did pay off
for
him.
Yeah.
I love these success stories. That's great. That networking is so important. And just even learning how to network.
Yeah.
If they start learning at the library, they are on their way.
And, of course, we also had a lot of the interns in the past have either stayed on at the library, mm-hmm. either part-time or on all on-call basis. Mm-hmm. And we've also have had past interns that have ended up working at that library.
Or going to library school, which is another great
outcome. Which is
outcome.
One of the goals of this,
That's
too.
That's one of the goals.
Interested in the career, yeah.
Right. So what leads to good experience for the library and the library staff? And that's important, too. Obviously, you want this experience to make a difference at the library as well. The intern might have skills that your staff do not possess, so you can certainly take advantage of those and learn yourself from those skills. The intern can help make a stale project fresh, bring in a new perspective. You know, when things are working, it's kind of nice not to change them. But, you know, sometimes you do need a change, and so they can help you do that. You notice where there is room for improvement because the intern is asking, well, why do you do that? Or, you know, I don't understand this particular policy. So, you know, it kind of brings it to the forefront that there might be a little bit of an issue there. A lot of times a library will say that they're getting new customers because they like to see that young face mm-hmm. there, or they know that young person, and so they're coming into the library. Again, like I said earlier, you'll discover that that intern might just make a great part-time or on-call employee, and so, hey, they know what's happening at the library, and if you call them to come in for a weekend afterwards, they would be able to help you out. And, of course, they've been working on something, whether it's your website or a new program or whatnot, and so you might be able to get more done because you do have one other person who's working on something for you. Okay, so there are some resources for you. These resources are, whether you have an internship grant or not, anyone can use these. If you go to and Mary Jo showed you are at Now Hiring at Your Library. We do have that internship page, and we have a lot of things that you can click on. There's an example of a timeline. Let's see.
Anyway, it's in this.
Yeah, it's age. It's definitely further down. But there's an example schedule of intern activities. There's a sample public library orientation plan, what to talk to your student about, whether they're working in that area or not. There is an employer guidebook developing successful internship programs, and that's for not just library interns, but all interns. And, of course, there's that internnebraska.com, which is that one stop for paid internships.
Where you can list your internship and college students will see it.
Mm-hmm. So, we are going to be talking a little bit more about the actual grant requirements. And then, of course, we're going to give Lori an opportunity to speak with us too. But are there any questions that you have right now before we move on to those sections?
If you have any questions about submitting a grant, anything about how to run a grant, run an internship, type into the questions section, raise your hand, you can ask and use your microphone.
Okay.
We'll talk about grant requirements, even though some of you are not grantees. It'll just give you an idea of
right.
how this works.
Right. And of course, some of you Nebraskans might be applying next year. Maybe I'll give you a heads up.
Or as you said, I think look for other places that might be offering these similar kind of funds.
Yeah.
It's not just us. We're not the only place giving out money for this kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Typically by now, the libraries that are receiving a grant would have already gotten their agreement. But this year is a little bit different. We haven't sent that out yet because since we're in a new administration, it's taking a little longer for the LSTA funds to find out what we're going to be getting as of the end of April. So you do have to wait to hire until we get that grant agreement out there and we have our signature on it. But when that arrives, go ahead and sign both copies and return those to us. There'll also be a request for a payment form. You need to sign and return that. That'll trigger that $1,000 check to your library. The internship window, as far as when you can have that intern, is you can't actually hire that person until you have signed that agreement, and of course, you haven't gotten it yet, and you need to wrap it up by the end of November. However, do go ahead and, we really think the money will be coming through, so go ahead and advertise. And you may also go ahead and interview students. Just let them know that, they won't be ready to come on board. You can't commit until those grant funds are secured for you. And then we do have some requirements as far as who can be selected. It does have to be a high school student or a college student. That can be a homeschooled high school student is also permissible. And that college student can be also a
non-traditionally aged student. Is that what you're going for?
No, they can already have their four-year degree, and they could be in perhaps
a graduate
student. That's what I was trying to think.
Well, they can also be a non-traditionally aged student.
Yes, right. Yeah. The student, however, cannot be someone who has been employed by a library in the past or currently, or have interned at a library in the past or currently. However, there are no restrictions on past or current volunteers. And of course, that's because we want more people to learn about the work of libraries.
We do have a little comment about the non-traditional age that you just mentioned. Monica Tideman is on the line with us from here in Nebraska. She said, I was a non-traditional age intern, and it worked out great.
Yes, it did, Monica. She said, library director now.
Yeah.
Very good. And as far as how the grant dollars can be spent, those dollars will be going directly to the intern, either through stipends or intern wages, and of course, if you're paying wages and need to withhold, FICA taxes, et cetera, part of that $1,000 can also go to that. But we really want to get those dollars into the intern hands. And then after the grant is over, we will be asking the library director to sign attesting how the grant funds were expended. And then there are supervisor responsibilities. Obviously, we want the supervisor to orient the student to the overview of library work, track their hours and activities, inform the intern about those library career and educational opportunities, complete the supervisor assessment at the end, instruct the intern to complete the baseline and follow-up surveys that we have, and that'll be on the first and last day of the internship or as close to those days as possible. And of course, every once in a while, I might send out a request, and hopefully you'll be responding to those on a timely basis as well.
One of those requests, those of you that have already done this will already know this, but one of those requests will be for photographs of your interns at work. We just love those, and some of them have been fantastic. We do need for you to get permission if there are other people in the photograph, which we hope there will be, get permission from them for us to use those photographs in social media and on the website and in print. And if they are children, we do need to have parental permission. So that just lets you know, gives you a head up, we want photographs.
Right. And there is everyone who was selected to receive a grant I did send an email, I believe it was last week, that had a document attached, about a five-page document. And in that document was a lot of different links and information, which also include the information about the pictures, the photo release, the releases to get them to sign before they fill out the survey. And so that document has a lot of great information for you. And so if you lose track of that, let me know and I'll send you another copy of that. Publicity. Obviously, it's a good opportunity to put out press when you have an intern. And I think it also will draw in new people if they know they have a new intern at the library. So, and we send out a press release here of the libraries that are will be receiving the grants. That is pending notice of those LSTA funds, so we haven't released that yet. But when you do publicity, definitely credit the Nebraska Library Commission in all your internship communication, and there's a little summary of what that should say. And that also, it will be in your agreement, and it is in that document that I mentioned that I emailed. And with that, we're going to have a few minutes to visit with Lori at the Wilson Public Library. They're a grant recipient this year, and they were last year, and I believe in the past as well. And hopefully, Lori will have some very specific tips on really what works in libraries.
Hi, Lori.
That's a lot of pressure.
Well, what worked in your library, and then people can adapt to their library.
Sure. Last year was our second year of having an intern, and I guess my first suggestion would be just to remember that every intern is different. Last year, our intern had the benefit of being a Boy Scout camp counselor, and he was an Eagle Scout. And so he really had a high level of ability to talk to people at lots of different levels. He wanted to go and is in computer technology in college now, but he was just trying to find his way. And I remember him just about every day he came in. He had some specific things for us he was doing, like researching ideas for portable makerspaces. And he would come in and just say, "Oh my gosh, Lori, did you know? Ba-ba-da-da-da-da-da." Or, "I could do this. Ba-da-da-da-da-da." And so every day we had conversations about, you know, did you know that you could use computer technology in a library? And so he had never before really thought of a library as a possibility for a career, but definitely left not only thinking about library science for a career, but also as far as creating programs on the technology front for libraries to use. So it was a win-win for us. And that was fantastic, but I'm going to take a step back as far as when I went to market and hire an intern. One suggestion I would have is be very clear on the marketing. I said earlier that we used Facebook, but I was not clear on the marketing. I knew in my head what I wanted to say, and I think it came across as we had a $1,000 stipend, and the person we were looking to hire would work up to 20 hours a week over a total of 8 weeks until the stipend was complete. For us in the library world, we know exactly what that means, but I had people coming back saying, "You have to pay the minimum wage, and if you work 20 hours a week for 8 weeks and only pay them $1,000, they're not even making, you know, whatever." So I had to step back and rephrase that to essentially say, "You're going to work 111 hours over 8 weeks total, but that will be decided at the time you're hired."
Yes, because who knows what their schedule is. They might be going on vacation for 2 weeks, you know.
Right. Well, yeah. And also with Colton, our intern, he ended up, because I was on our local tourism board and I was saying that we got this grant, the local museums thought that, hey, they could maybe do something and find some money to pay for him as well. So he ended up, I don't want to say sharing, because we paid him and he worked for us, but he got another job over at the museum on the days that he didn't work here at the library, and did similar things.
So they got the idea from your internship, hearing about yours, to do one themselves, the museum.
Right. So I feel really good about that. And the other thing is, because this was our second intern, we got word out to the schools. Like I said, we collaborated with the schools, and they got the information for marketing out. But they now see us as a viable place to put work-study students during the school year. They have seniors that are interested in certain things. They're non-paying positions, but I have tried for probably 5 years to even make that connection with the schools, and I've always kind of run into the, well, anybody can do that. So for me to hire Colton and our first intern, who was a straight-A student, and have them go back to the schools and say what a fantastic experience this was, made the library come up in the eyes of the schools that we were a viable place to put high-achieving students.
Now that's a great story.
It is, and it's interesting how you can tell that to the school, and then it has a certain effect, and the students go back and tell them after they've had the experience, and it has a very different effect.
Oh, absolutely.
Sometimes that's what we need, is spokespersons that...
Yeah. Yeah, I'm always talking to our patrons about being an ambassador for the library, because people are going to listen more to them than they do me, because I'm always saying the same things. So they need to hear it from somebody else. Anyway, like I said, Colton came and he did lots of technology stuff for us. He set up lots of technology. We're actually just kind of riding the coattails on that. But the other point I wanted to put as far as hiring an intern, because we had so many people apply, and we had high schoolers and college students apply because Kearney is so close to us, I had 5 fantastic interviews that I felt confident I could have hired any of those for interns. And they would have done amazing jobs. They all had different strengths, different weaknesses. So I felt very fortunate in getting Colton. But that said, this winter I lost a part-time employee, and I could not find anyone to take that person's place. And I already had a high school student hired, and I was just kind of beside myself because I needed that position filled. And I finally went to my library board and the city council, and I said, is there any way that I could hire a second high school student? I have a couple of people who did great in their interviews. I know they don't have jobs. I know they would be fantastic at the library, and they could spend their 6-month training period training, so when my high school senior leaves this summer, then I will look for another adult to hire. And they said, absolutely, you can hire another high school student. And I think that's because of the success that we've had the last 2 years with our intern. I did contact one of the students who had a tremendous interview and ended up hiring him. So he is working now. And it's just a great thing. Colton was male. My new high school student is male, and that is just a different feel to our staff to have a male on board in a small town. Colton appealed to a lot of the little boys who were just at that age about libraries aren't cool, that's a girl thing, and we probably have more boys come in than we do girls right now. Arturo, who I hired from the interviews for a part-time job, he was not an intern for us, he speaks fluent Spanish. So we now have a whole nother base coming in that, one, see him as a male, but two, he has the ability to speak Spanish. So it's really, this grant has opened up a lot of doors for our library.
Wow, we love hearing this.
Yeah, so it's like I said, it's not necessarily just the benefits we get from the intern and what the interns get from us, but the ability to look at a wider picture and say, wow, you know, what if I go this route or what if I go this route? This year we're looking at building upon the maker technology that Colton started. And I am really hoping that some of those high school students who applied last year who didn't get the job will reapply this year. Like I said, I know that one of my seniors is leaving. She's going to a school out of state, so I'm going to have to hire somebody. But it'll be so great for me if I don't have an adult work pool to choose from this fall that I can go back to the library board and say, hey, look, this was an intern for us and he or she did this and we would really love to have him for another year or two. So I think it's a win-win for everybody.
And I think that one of the things we don't emphasize a great deal, but that's always on our mind, is how this internship experience affects the community. And obviously, when you talk about one of the interns or one of the students that gets hired being a Spanish-speaking person, that really affects the community because, like you said, it opens the door to people who feel more comfortable speaking Spanish in the library when they know one of the people who works there does, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, that's like what JoAnn had on one of the slides, that don't just focus on what you think you want the internship for. Look at the skills of who you're getting interviewed and things to fit them. Yeah,
right.
That's what I like about our internship grants and program. We've done this presentation here on NCompass Live for a few years. It's so flexible. Nothing is in stone. It's not like you have to come up with an idea and then totally stick with that. If things totally change, just let JoAnn know.
Yeah.
We're switching things up because we discovered they can do this. And
Well, and for us, it's really fun to hear people like Lori tell their story mm-hmm. and to know what goes on after we send out the grants.
Well, and the other thing that I think we do well as a staff and as a library is we bring those interns right on board as equals. So they're not only... They don't only have their specialized goals for what they need to accomplish for the internship program, but they're opening or they're closing. They're helping our community members just like any other staff member. And I think by treating them as equals, they rise to the occasion. Mm-hmm. And they suddenly see that, oh, when I go out in the real world, these are things I need to think about. We have a lot of political conversations at our library. And, I think for especially the last two interns that we've had have been high school students. I think it's just kind of expanded their mind that, oh, the library has a budget to worry about. Oh, how do you get your money? You know, they don't really talk about those things in schools, and for the most part, even our patrons don't really understand how a public library is run. So when I talked earlier about I encourage my patrons to be ambassadors for the library, I really rely on those interns to be ambassadors for the library too, to go back to the high school and say, hey, this is really a cool place, and did you know this? Arturo, like I said, he wasn't an intern, but he's now one of my part-time people. He came in the other day talking about how all the kids' iPads up at the high school crashed, and they were working on a huge report. And I looked up at him. I said, please tell me you used the Nebraska Access databases, because that, of course, is one of my talking points that the teachers hear me say all the time, and they never use. And he looks at me and goes, Lori, that is a great resource. And I said, please tell me that you're telling all the students up there what a great resource it is. And he goes, I am.
So, all right.
Yeah. Like I said, I just think getting them to be that ambassador and tell their friends or tell the other kids. Arturo was looking through our DVDs maybe a month ago, and he said, we have all the Games of Thrones DVDs? And I said, yeah. And he goes, you need to do a better job of marketing this to the high school, Lori. I'm like, oh, okay, why don't you tell your friends that? And then the word of mouth can go. And he goes, oh, kind of like, I can do that? Absolutely, you can do that.
Well, that sounds great, Lori. Thank you so much. We do have
gosh, this time goes by so fast. What time is it?
No problem. It says 10:58 on my
computer. Ooh, sorry, no folks. Problem. Okay. Questions and answers.
Yep, certainly type in your questions. And while you're typing in, I just want to kind of page through a few more slides that we have here that just shows what our 27 funded library applications said was their intern was we're going to be doing this year. Just to give you some ideas of what you can get them to do. You want to back up on that one? We had, obviously, a lot do summer reading, story time, book discussion groups. Somebody's going to be having them help with the Nebraska's 150th observation, which is this year. Some mystery nights and some escape room activities. And, of course, they take them for outreach outside the library. There's lots of special type projects, learning materials, tutorials, lesson plans for maker clubs, organizing a teen advisory board, critique the library's new website that's going to be coming online this summer, review the procedure manuals to identify understandability issues, and a lot of technology type stuff. Obviously, students are good at that. Updating the website, planning and teaching computer classes, adding management software applications and content to mobile devices, and just general support of digital learning. And this year, we actually had a few libraries talk about makerspace-related things, and of course, we knew COSAD did that last year, and I think they'll be working on that again this year. But just look at all those things related to makerspaces.
Producing videos, yep. A lot of stuff.
Yep. We always see things about social media and public relations, and that's important. And a lot get those students doing creativity, like bulletin boards and leading crafts and taking photos, videos, book displays. And then, of course, your general library-type book-related work, working at the circulation desk, and things that you do on a daily basis there. And of course, assisting customers. And I think it is really good to have your students working directly with customers as well. And then, and like Lori mentioned, and I know Skylar always tries to get someone who is also a Spanish speaker, which helps bring in new customers as well. And here are your successful grant applicants from this year. So you know who will be having interns, assuming that funding comes through, and we sure are hoping that it will. I think it's just a matter of time.
So if you have any questions and you're typing them in now, we'll hold off.
Yep, but we don't get cut off here at 11, obviously. If you have any desperate questions you urgently want to ask of JoAnn or Mary Jo or Lori, get it typed in there, and we will get answered. Otherwise, of course, you always know where to find everybody.
Contact JoAnn. She's got all the answers.
And, of course, we have other past intern supervisors on the line, too. So if any of you wanted to share anything, that would be fine as well.
Lori, is there any last words you want to toss out before we do wrap up for today or while people are typing?
No, but I need to get started on my marketing as I sat here. And listened to
Thank you so much, Lori.
You're welcome.
And thanks, everyone, for joining us today.
Yep. I guess it doesn't look like anybody has any urgent questions right now that's coming in. That's okay. You know where JoAnn is.
And you'll be able to access this, obviously, the recorded version and all of these overheads. Probably by tomorrow.
Yeah.
So,
Yep, should be able to get it up today, hopefully, if not tomorrow.
And the links to all the other outside.
Yes, all the website links and things that they mentioned during the presentation I've grabbed and put into our Delicious account, so they'll be available to you afterwards, the resources as well.
Thanks, Kristen.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, JoAnn and Mary Jo and Lori, if you're still here. Yeah, if you're still there. and everyone for attending. That will wrap it up for this week's NCompass Live. And we'll get this up here. All right. You type NCompass Live into the keyboard over there, and we'll get to our website. This will be put onto our website.
Is that it right there? NCompass Live? No.
No, that's,
no,
oh, well,
that's something else.
That's a particular one. Yeah.
Okay. There. Oh, no.
Two separate words.
Two separate
words. Yeah.
Okay. Right. There we got it.
And then, there we go. Generally, so far, we are the only thing calling itself NCompass Live on the internet, so you can Google, you can search us wherever you are, and you can see it even comes up with our recent ones. This is the link for today's show saying, hey, sign up for today's. But our main page, this is where our recordings will be, right here underneath where we have our upcoming shows. We have all of our previous sessions here. This was just last week's project outcome. Recording, presentation, and links. Today's will be the same thing. When it's ready, I will announce in our usual ways of sharing, and all of you who were attending, registered for today's show, will get an email as well. So that will wrap it up for today's show. Hope you join us next week when our topic is summer reading program, something we mentioned today that you can possibly use an intern.
It's coming up. Summer's coming, everybody.
Yes. Our regular annual session on current year's topic. Sally Snyder, our coordinator of Children's and Young Adult Library Services here at the Library Commission, every year does a session on new books that you can use for summer reading program. And the theme this year is Build a Better World. They've kind of switched from having a teen and a children's theme, and it's the same theme for both. So she will share new titles about that on next week's show. So definitely do sign up for that one.
And isn't that a great theme? I mean, it can be Build a Better World, literally, the construction of a better world.
There's some construction titles. There's some things that are more about doing good things that will build. It's a very
making the world better. I think that's a great theme for adults, too, actually.
Yes. Well, they do have, actually, if you look at the summer reading program, there is actually children's, teen, and adult summer reading program resources. So it's not just a kids thing anymore. They do have the adult summer reading programs at a lot of libraries.
Fabulous.
So I'll sign up for that and any of our other upcoming shows we have. Also, we are on Facebook. We did mention Facebook earlier, too. So if you are a big Facebook user, do pop over there and give us a like. Ignore that because we're not going to log in right now. I do post when our sessions are starting up. Here's a reminder to log in today's show. When the recordings are ready, I post on here. If you are big on Facebook, please do give us a like over there. Back to our page. Where's our page? There it is. All right. Other than that, yes, that does wrap it up for today's show. I don't see any other last comments, so I think we will call it a morning. All right. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Thank you, everybody, for presenting. We'll see you next time on NCompass Live. Bye-bye.
Bye.